Every legal avenue was used to try to keep the terrorist killed by police in an Auckland supermarket in prison, the Prime Minister revealed today. The attacker was just released in July after 3 years in jail and came under constant police surveillance. The Crown applied for GPS monitoring but was denied by the courts. Also confirmed, the man arrived in New Zealand in 2011 on a student visa, aged 22. Now our two biggest political parties are joining forces to pass in urgency tougher new anti-terrorism laws by the end of the month. Seven people were injured in the attack in the Auckland suburb of New Lynn. Five are in hospital. Three are in a critical condition. Police today saying there will be more visible patrols around supermarkets. We've again got extensive coverage. The One News team is live with the very latest. We begin tonight with political editor Jessica Much Mackay, and a warning, some viewers may find elements of her story upsetting.
This unassuming building is the Glen Eden Mosque. It was home to the attacker. He was living here under court-ordered supervision. Today, police are trying to piece together how this happened.
Shocked, absolutely shocked. I mean, my family's shocked. Friends over the shore are shocked.
In the lead up to this attack,
there's someone here with a knife, babe. He's got a knife.
He'd been jailed for 3 years and faced charges around carrying a hunting knife, posting extremist views on Facebook, and having objectionable videos. In 2017, he was also stopped at Auckland Airport, believed to be heading for Syria.
Oh, bro! Oh, no! Oh, bro, look what happened, bro.
He died at the scene. We can't show his face or name him yet, but the Prime Minister says she won't anyway.
No terrorist, whether alive or deceased, deserves their name to be shared for the infamy they were seeking.
But his name has been well known to authorities for 5 years. Changes to the counter-terrorism laws were going through to deal with people like him. The first stage passed earlier this year, and there have been multiple calls to hurry up.
It's not fit for purpose and hasn't been for about 20 years.
Last year, in a rare move, a judge who dealt with the attacker said New Zealand has an Achilles heel because the law doesn't protect against those planning a terror attack. The police commissioner and other officials also asked the government to speed up the changes, and it was working on it yesterday, the day of the attack.
I do not think it's fair to make an assumption that that law change in itself would have made the difference in this case. We don't know that to be true, but what you can see that based on the level of offending we had, those legal avenues were all used. Everything available to us was used. And when we were exhausted those options of keeping that person in prison, that is when the monitoring stepped in.
We have pursued all avenues with this case, including reasonably creatively at times to try and manage it.
Judith Collins messaged the Prime Minister last night to say she'll support any law changes despite not supporting a review in 2013.
That's just sort of pointless when you've got to move on, and obviously the threats that we have now, or the threats we've had the last few years, are not the same that we had 8 years ago.
The legal changes are on the way.
March the 15th gave us a very, very big wake-up call, and I don't know if we quite woke up.
Nobody wanted September the 3rd to become another dark day in our history.
And Jess joins us now. Lots of details revealed today about the attacker, Jess, but why couldn't he be deported?
So this man came to New Zealand 10 years ago as a 22-year-old on a student visa from Sri Lanka. So of course there are questions about his residency status and exactly what Immigration New Zealand were able to do. But those details are suppressed until 11 p.m. tonight. The justification is that to give his family who are overseas some time. So as soon as we're able to and those details come in, we will keep you updated on those.